Chick-fil-A, Chick-fil-A, gotta have my Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A, Chick-fil-A, eat them up, yum. I got a flyer this morning from the teachers at the school. It's called Walk in Solidarity. This Red for Ed campaign has got me kind of like, yeah, confused. A little bit like, I understand teachers want more money, and I think they should get it, of course, no problem, right? There's been some uproar from parents who are upset that their teenagers are asked to join in on this fight. And that's the part I'm not so sure I agree with. Don't get the students involved in your fight. But parents, I think it'd be good to get the teachers, to get parents' support. Because we're adults, you know, we can make our own decisions. But don't try to convince a kid that they need to help you fight your battle for you. I mean, with you or whatever. So anyways, when I got this flyer, I started to read. I mean, I got a little choked up watching them hand out flyers with their red shirts on. And I got a little choked up and held it back really quickly because I'm like, why am I getting upset about them handing out flyers? This is weird, right? And then I read the flyer and it talked about all the media information that's out there about teacher pay, like the news reports and the radios and all that stuff. Like one for a small example is the radio media claims that 9% increase, there has been a 9% increase in teacher salaries since 2015. And then that's what they're claiming, that teachers have been getting 9% increase, and that's quite a bit is what they're saying, right? But the context, here's the truth behind that, is more than half of that went to hire new teachers due to student growth. Actual salaries increased only 4.6%. So I'm reading through these little claims and then the context that tells you where they're getting their claim from. And I'm starting to get choked up realizing that, yeah, these teachers are fighting for their pay. They're fighting to keep teaching. And they really should pay teachers more so that more teachers will want to teach and teach well because they get paid well to do it. They'd be fighting for jobs. They've been fighting for these well-paying jobs and doing their best at it so they don't get fired and someone else replace them, you know? But anyway, I just wanted to say a quick thing about the teacher thing because it really was emotional to me this morning. Like, I really was inspired by their fight, and I've always wanted to be a teacher, I guess is why maybe I'm kind of connected to that, and I'm not, because I get paid more to not be a teacher. So I can't follow my dream because it doesn't pay well, you know, and I need at least 15 bucks an hour to survive, and I don't even think they get that. Anyway, I'm going to talk about another couple subjects next, but I'm going to take a bite of my burrito, and then we're going to come back. Today is April 10th, 2018. So, yesterday was interesting. Monday was rather a busy day for me at work, and even though it was busy, I was determined to get this thought process out of my head. The thought process was trying to explain to my therapist, because my appointments are on Monday nights, and today's Tuesday. I wanted to be able to explain to my therapist how I went into this depression, went a little crazy in my mind and in my heart and in my soul, and then I was able to come out of it. Because I feel like the more information that I can process within myself, then the better advice that he can give me as far as how to cope better, healthier ways to cope. Because I don't feel like I did too bad this weekend compared to other times when I felt that terrible. But I don't like jumping straight to, oh, I wish I was dead, when it gets really bad. And I jump there a lot, and I'm tired of jumping there. I want to prevent it from crashing that bad. Or if I am crashing that bad, what's the alternative thing for me to do so it doesn't feel that bad, right? I don't know if that makes sense. So, anyway, I made up this little chart. And in my mind, I'm like, okay, there's going to be this point where my mind can go this way, or it can stay on the track and be good and healthy. And sometimes I do good and healthy, and sometimes I go off the track. So then in my mind, I thought of it as like a board game, and how you can climb the ladder, you know, skip all the drama over here, climb the stairs, skip all the drama over here, and if I go doop 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 doop, I'm home free, and I'm to a good, healthy point in my mind and in my heart and in my soul, and it's all about what I'm feeling, not so much about what he's doing, right? So I guess I got a couple of things I want to talk about. I want to talk about this board game and the step-by-step. And then I'm going to talk about the emotional abuse versus the enmeshment part. So I'm going to read this to you. Hi, my name is Crystal. I am a happy, loving wife who is also a little too enmeshed. Many times I feel responsible for Jim's feelings. So I accommodate, placate, bend over backwards, and walk on eggshells to keep him happy. I even hide things, too. Sometimes I feel strong and give him the true me. If he doesn't agree, or if he disapproves, in any way, I get scared. If we still can't work it out, then I doubt myself and him. This makes me super sad. I get very depressed, and then I might even think crazy thoughts and cope in unhealthy ways. Then, eventually, I become meh, blah, ugh, or numb. Eventually, I find my inner strength. I become optimistic, positive, and hopeful about my future. I remind myself that I am not a victim. I have choice. When I am happy, I can be silly, sweet, productive, and fulfilled. I am the best me. There are times when I get pissed, but instead of voicing my anger, I might get revengeful and find a way to be okay in secret. Or I might get bitter and snap at everyone. Or I might try to go back to a numb state. But eventually, I just go back to Crystal. Crazy Crystal. Calm down, Crystal. Until I climb back down to blah me, numb me, meh. This is the me that Jim feels safest with. And when Jim is happy, I am happy. And then I feel good. And when I feel good, I can grow. A happy growing crystal is a better crystal. And the future looks bright. Unless Jim disapproves. Oh no. And then it shows my little drawing there of me falling back into the rabbit hole. Into crazy crystal, depressed crystal. And then it just goes right back to the cycle. My therapist thought it was great. I shared it with him. And he was very pleased that I knew where how the cycle goes. And he was happy to see that I am very aware of the cycle and how it goes. And there's a lot of times that I can skip from. Sometimes I feel strong and give him the true me. I remind myself that I am not a victim and I have choice. That's the ladder where I give him the true me and I'm not a victim. So no matter what his response is, I try to climb the ladder to work on me and not care about him. And so this thought process has been growing forever now, right? But the last meeting I had with Eugene, our marriage therapist, and then the other one that I had with our marriage counselor that's doing the Gottman method, and my own personal therapist, I feel that no matter what my husband's doing, I feel I'm hearing everybody say, I'm pretty sure I hear everybody saying, that's his personality, that's what he's going to do. You already know that's what he's going to do, but now you've got to push through, put up your boundaries, say you're going to do this anyway, stop asking him to approve, stop asking him to do this, blah 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 blah, right? And I'm just like, I hear you, that makes sense, that's harder than it says, that's harder than it looks. I don't want to say that I can't do it, but it's like practically impossible. And I couldn't put my finger on why I felt like it was impossible for days and days, and then I just felt myself getting more depressed last week. Like, what is it? Why can't I just stand up to him? What is it? What am I so afraid of, right? And then I realized and recognized, and I may have talked about it, I don't remember anymore, that it's not so much that I can't detach myself and just work on me. It's that my husband doesn't let me. He is just as enmeshed as I am. And he also does this emotional abuse thing. I don't even think he recognizes when he's doing it. And that behavior needs to stop. So I told my therapist, I said, at what point do I stop blaming myself for being so enmeshed and recognizing that his behavior needs to be better so that I can be happier? I mean, that's not enmeshment, right? I feel depressed and upset and angry and sorry for myself when his behavior is not okay. And so my small example from Saturday is that he said the word obsessed, and I stood up for myself, and rather than him respecting me and apologizing for calling me obsessed, he gaslighted me and made me feel like I shouldn't have said anything and started to throw a fit and just was really irritated with me and basically calling me impossible to improve with and everything because I couldn't let things go or I think too black and white or whatever. So he's just being very he was psychologically trying to find flaws with me standing up for myself. I really don't appreciate you calling me obsessed is all I said, right? And he just went off and the mood changed and I was just so done and I was so tired of this, right? So it's like I kick myself for taken his emotional abuse so dang seriously when that's not what I was shooting for. I wasn't shooting to be enmeshed in it, but my therapist last night helped me see that that wasn't enmeshment when I got upset. I was literally, truly have the right to be upset that his behavior and his reaction towards me is fundamentally wrong. He shouldn't treat me like crap just because I was standing up for myself. Anyway, after my therapy appointment last night, I knew my husband wasn't going to be too happy. I knew that he was going to be angry because I didn't come home after work yesterday. I got held up with Sally and it took longer than I expected, and I communicated all of this to my husband so that he wasn't in the dark about why I wasn't coming home. I intended on coming home anyway, but it didn't work out that way. So I went straight to my appointment, and when I got to my appointment and did my hour and then came home, I knew my husband was going to be disappointed and upset and having his jealous feelings and insecurities and whatever feelings. But I just kept saying to myself, I'm not responsible for his feelings. I'm not responsible for his feelings. And yet, in some way, I felt like it was my job to show him love and show him admiration. And I felt that that would be my best bet to give him what he needs so that I don't hear his wrath. Isn't that manipulative, right? I wouldn't want to call it manipulative. It might be, but I just feel like that's how desperate I was. So I'm going off of our magic moment from the other peanut butter and jelly the other day, and I just stroke his arms and I love him and I said, hey, and he's feeling all weird and everything. And I'm like, he's like, why are you acting like this? And I'm like, I just want to love you and go off of our magic moment from the other night. And after several minutes of me just continuing to love him anyway and not trying to take responsibility for his feelings, yet I still felt like it was my job to love him up. Is that half backwards? I don't know. He said, I'm just going through some stuff right now. You were with your therapist for the last hour and now you want to love on me. And I'm like, that's not why. And he goes, I know. I'm just having a moment here. So if you can just not take it personally, keep doing what you're doing, keep being happy and loving. And I'm like, okay, good. Thank you. Because that was actually big of him to say. Big improvement. Big moment for him that he was able to see that he's the one having a moment right now and he's allowing me to be me while he goes through his moment. And I wasn't responsible for his moment. I wasn't responsible for his jealousy. I wasn't responsible to make him feel better. So he said, you keep doing what you want to do. You want to love me or be happy or whatever. You keep doing. I'm not going to stop that. I know it's me. And that was big. And then we ended up doing a little fun intimacy game that lasted forever, and we made really great love and we went to bed. So this morning we're having a good morning, and I'm tired, I'm frustrated, and I'm hopeful. So that's all. I'll talk to y'all later. I'm gonna go inside to work.